I think discipleship has the reputation, in the Christian world at least, of being a very religious thing, sort of a church activity you go to on Wednesday night.
RVL, scene one, take one.
Imagine that the Bible describes a path. We spend a lot of time helping students to understand what that path is, and we stop there. A disciple is not simply someone who knows what God's path is, but chooses to walk it passionately, not simply in religious activities, so-called, but in everyday life. So we want to tell them, we want to judge them, we want to pass laws to force them. I want to show them what God is like. What would it look like if we not only knew the path, but we chose to walk it? That's, I think, what Jesus came to tell us how to do.
I know you've been a Bible teacher now 45 years. You start every class with it. You even say it in multiple languages. I want to ask you about the Shema. What does that have to do with discipleship?
When I first began to be involved in the Jewish community, the religious Jewish community, I noticed that the Shema was recited often in the Jewish setting. And I loved that because it seemed to me it focused their minds, hearts, souls on God every day. Shema and discipleship are really two sides of one coin. So in my own personal life, I rarely will sit in my prayer time without saying Shema first. It goes like this: Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha, Bechol Levavcha, Uvachol Nafshecha, Uvachol Meodecha. And then I add what Jesus did, Ve'ahavta L'Reyacha Kamocha, Amen. By saying it in that original language, even if maybe we don't pronounce it exactly the way they did, is a way of reminding ourselves that those words were relevant to God's people right from the very beginning of when He formed them into a nation and a community. We say it in English to remind ourselves that while it was completely relevant at their moment in history, it is just as relevant in the 21st century, so let's use a modern language. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, and love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. Jesus was walking with his disciples and teaching, and some educated Jewish scholar came up to him and asked Jesus, "What's the greatest commandment?" Now that sounds sort of strange, but two things you ought to note. One, there are literally thousands of commandments in their Bible. And so people spent time engaged in the discussion, which one is the greater? What happens if you have two commandments that seem to contradict themselves? Let's imagine you're driving on the Sabbath day. You're a firm believer that you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath day. And as you're driving along, you see an elderly couple in the car in front of you skid off the highway and down into the ditch. And there they sit. And you know there's no way that elderly couple is going to get out of the ditch unless you help them. But that's work. So what do? Which commandment is greater? Love your neighbor or don't work on the Sabbath? That was their discussion. But what I wanted to show you is that Jesus had an answer instantly. So that tells me that Jesus had thought about this in his human nature. And in his mind, the great commandment, the one that supersedes all others, is this one. So let's talk briefly this morning about what is the Shema and what does it mean. Shema is translated in your English Bible as hear. Can you hear me? But in Hebrew, it's a much broader term than that. 90% of the time in the Bible, the word Shema is translated as obey. So Shema means to do it. It's not simply hear these words, it's do them. So we need to ask, what are we being called to do? Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Now, Echad has two Hebrew meanings at least. Most Bible versions choose, Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. But it has another meaning that was far more central, I believe, in the biblical period. That wasn't their issue. Their problem is that there were many, 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 many gods. In Egypt, 1,200. So what they wanted to say is that Echad can mean only or alone, because that was their issue in the Roman world. Is it Jupiter? Is it Mars? Is it Asclepius? No, it's the God of Moses, the one whose name we don't say, and he is our God alone. Now, that makes this not a statement of belief only. It makes it a loyalty oath. And you have to decide, is it Echad or not? Now, what did I commit to? Ve ahavta. Ve means and. Ahavta means to love. Levavcha. Very simple. We almost always translate that word as heart. Nafshecha. It simply means your soul, which to them meant your feelings, your emotions. So if you know Levavcha means heart, and that's your operating system, Nafshecha means soul, it's your emotion or feelings. And this one I really like, because this one is the hardest for me. Meodecha. We translate it might or strength, but it's bigger than that, as you'd expect. Meodecha means with everything you have. Not only your muscle, but your talents. Not only your muscle and your talents, but every dime you have, including that car that's parked in the parking lot. So for me, I've always felt called to be a teacher, but I find it's an enormous temptation to try and be a teacher and not depend on God. I've done this for 44 years. So how do I make sure when I come here in the morning, this isn't just, okay, you've done this 44 years, just wing it. I don't want to wing it. I want to give God every second of my day, including my teaching time. So Shema is a big deal to me, because if you mean it, you're standing behind me saying, RVL, today, as a husband, as a dad, as a grandpa, as a teacher, Shema! That's the kind of people Jesus wanted as disciples. It's not that, oh, I can't be a nurse, I gotta be a missionary, or a pastor, or a Bible study leader. God says, awesome! You catch it. I've given you the abilities to be a nurse, I've given you the mind to study, I've given you the compassion for people. Now do it as a disciple! And that's true for all of you. But he's going to expect you're all in. It's not part-time. But in God's mind, this is a big deal. Are we all in? Are you going to give every ounce you've got? Are you going to leave nothing out on the field? Is this everything you have? Is God really God alone for you? Or do you find there are other voices that we tend to be drawn to? In addition, or maybe instead of, there are other gods, there are other voices, there are other loyalties. Do you want to be all in? And I want to be able to look God in the eye at the end of the day and say, I didn't give much compared to what you can do. But I left nothing on the field today. Nothing. I was brought up in a very religious family, in a very religious setting, in Christian school, Christian college, Christian seminary, went to Israel. And we were in a synagogue in Galilee. And the professor, Jewish professor, was teaching the story of Luke 4, where Jesus went to Nazareth. And they said to him, perform a miracle here. They're all excited about him. They're amazed at his teaching, it says. And Jesus said, there isn't going to be any miracles here today. And the professor was explaining that in Jewish tradition, the reason there was no miracle was because they were trusting the fact that they were God's people. They hadn't personally committed themselves to being what God's people were called to be. Now, whether he was right or wrong, it struck me that up till that point in my life, my knowledge of God and of Scripture was an intellectual knowledge. That I knew the Scriptures quite well because I had grown up so religious, that I believed the Scriptures. I believed Jesus was my Savior, but it had never gone here. I wasn't really living the Shema with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my might. I was content with my intellectual understanding and commitment. And at that moment, I decided that my commitment needed to be kicked up several notches. And because he had saved me, I wanted to become like him in order to be his disciple, living the Shema every moment of every day.